while since I've made a video about this boat, and I've done quite a few things over the past year. I'd like to talk to you about tacking and jibing, a safety knife, a tiller extension, a safety ladder, having an anchor, how to find leaks in your boat and how to fix them, how to stop your jib lines from catching at the front of your mast, installing a comfortable seat, your riding rope placement, electric winches, and light wind tacking and jibing. Now the boat model. This is a highly modified Hobie Wave. You might like to have a look at my videos, Hobie Wave modifications to go faster, and Hobie Wave easy load trailer. That's spelled E-Z-Y. If you've capsized your boat, or heaven forbid you've fallen off of it, you'll probably end up here trying to get back onto your boat, and probably in about this position. Now these boats are fairly high up out of the water, so to get back on the boat is actually pretty difficult. A mate of mine last year, who was trying to get back on his boat, was down here pulling himself up and he dislocated his shoulder. So to assist us with getting back on the boat, we've got ladders now on the front of our boat, and I'll show you how these operate. So when you're down in the water, just a matter of taking off the bungee cord, undoing the ladder and letting the ladder come out. Now these ladders hang straight down from the boat. Now trying to get up on that ladder is going to be fairly hard, because when you step on the bottom rung, the ladder is going to want to go under your boat. So to stop that from happening, we've attached cords to the end of the ladder, and on the end of the rope we've got a clip. Now that clip goes around the front of your spreader bar like that, on each side. So one clip there and one clip here. I won't do that up. And once you've done that, that'll stop the ladder from going back under your boat. So if you haven't got a spreader bar, you can take this clip and just mount it in here. So no spreader bar, easy fix, just put it in there. And that'll make it much easier for you to get back on your boat. For those of you who have never capsized your boat in strong winds, you'll know that if you don't hang on to your boat pretty quick, your boat is going to float away from you. And last year that happened with me. I was tossed off the boat, and it was only my friend who came to the rescue to get me. If I'd been on my own, my boat would have drifted probably a couple of kilometres away from me, and I just would have been left stranded out in the water. And what happens is that the boat goes over, the anchor will grab, the anchor will stop your boat from moving away. I'll also show you in the video some other uses for the anchor. Now you may think in the event of a capsize that this could fall into your main or your jib if you've got one, but I found that when the boat goes over, it just goes straight in the water and stays clear of your sails. Don't you just love those magpies? Now, a little bit about the anchor setup. You want to get an anchor similar to this. You don't want to get one with prongs all over it, so that you end up getting spiked in the head. This actually sits nicely in this tray. This tray has a couple of cutouts here and over there, and then one here. So when the anchor sits in there, it sits nicely in the tray. Now, there is about 6 meters of rope in here, and I'll just show you what's attached to the end of this rope. Now what I've got attached to the end of this rope is probably a meter of double bungee, which acts like a shock absorber. If your boat's at anchor and pulls against the anchor, it's not going to pull your anchor out of the ground. And then at the end of the bungee, just have something like this. I just happen to have this in the shed, but just a clip. And then I usually just put my clip around the hiking strap like that. All my rope in the tray, and that's all nice and neat and out of the way. I also need to say that the anchor needs to be sitting on top of your rope, not under your rope. So in the event of a capsize, the anchor goes over first, and then the rope follows it. Now the other thing is, I've never pitch poled this boat. I've only capsized it four times. In the event of a pitch pole, if you had a jib, the anchor may become entangled in the jib. So I'm not quite sure how it would work in a pitch pole, but it definitely works if you have a capsize. Now initially when I thought of the anchor idea, I thought about mounting it on the spreader bar on the front of the boat, but personally I didn't like the look of it, so I mounted it here. If you mounted it on your spreader bar, you're almost certain to get your anchor into the water and to not foul your jib or your main at all. And it would also come out of its tray in the event of a pitch pole. So that's your choice. You might like to mount it on your front spreader bar. Yeah, if you don't want to drag your boat up on the beach every time you're coming into the beach, and you want to keep it away from incoming swells if you're sailing in the ocean, if you've got an anchor, you can just drop your anchor to its full length and stretch the bungee and just leave it at the water's edge. On light wind days, I will often unclip the main, tie up the jib and just drop the anchor and let the boat drift. Now this saves me having to lift the boat at all. It's also useful at the end of the day to come in and just take out your anchor and leave your boat at the beach while you go and get your car and your trailer, without fear of your boat drifting off into the sea. Having an anchor also means that on really light wind days, you can just drop your anchor over the side, and as I often do, if the wind has dropped, and have a bit of a rest on your boat and wait for the wind to pick up, then pull it back onto the boat. It's pretty easy getting it back on when your bungee cord attached to the end, back in its box, and off you go. Well, leaks in your boat. My mate, who had a brand new Hobie, took it out first day. At the end of the day, took out the bungs and there was water coming out the boat. So even new Hobie boats do leak. There are a number of places that they can leak, and I'm going to show you how to find the leak. One of the places that they often leak is in the access plate, which you can't see, which is under each seat. So you've got four of those. And they are classic places where a Hobie can leak. But anyway, I'll show you how to find the leaks and how to fix them. Now, if you want to find any holes in your boat, you've literally got to blow it up. Yeah, we're going to blow it up with this piece of hose. Just grab a reasonable length of hose, flush it out first, make sure there's no spiders in it. Undo your bum, or take out your bum, put it in a safe place, put the hose. Make sure it's a tight fit. If it's not a tight fit, you can use a bit of plumbing tape. And then, what we're going to do is we're going to blow it up with about, oh, I don't know, 12 breaths. After that, put a kink in the hose so the air doesn't come out. And just put it at the back of your rudder. Now you've got a whole lot of pressure in your hull, and we're going to try and find some leaks. And we'll do that by seeing if there's any air coming out of any of the obvious spots. you can find leeks around here. Now these leeks won't be obvious at all, because there may be a small crack in the hull that's inside there, inside where you can't really see it. Over time, with extended use and perhaps going out in rough water, you can get a small crack in there. Now this is just under your boat, where your trampoline is attached into a track, and you can see there's a whole lot of silicon here, but there's screws all the way along there, and you may just have a leak in there. Now I showed you one point where the bar goes through the hole. There's a number of points where the bar goes through the hole. These are worth having a look at as well and checking. In fact, sometimes when you put the air in, you can actually hear the air coming out, so it's easy to find the hole. Now, two of the most obvious spots for a Hobie to leak are under the seat. Under each seat, there is an access hole, and what you do is get some soapy water and just spray around the seat. Now we use the soapy water because if there's any leaks under the seat, the soapy water is going to blow bubbles. Use the soapy water on the other points that I showed you, or any other point of your boat that you think might be leaking. Another place that you find leaks. Now believe it or not, another place where the Hobie can leak is at the bung. I only found this out last year. Even after putting the bungs in hand tight, I now carry in the car a little spanner so I can do them up extra tight. You'll find that it's amazing the amount of water that can seep in through a bung. Now, having shown you one source of a leak that you may not have thought of, being a bung, it's interesting to note, and some people don't take this into account, is that particularly these hulls, rotor molded hulls, which are quite thick plastic, they get quite hot, and the air inside them also gets quite hot. So there you are, you're transporting your boat, you're putting it on the beach, it's getting all nice and hot, and then you do up your bung and you go in the water. What happens is that the air inside your boat starts to cool and it contracts, and so your boat is now sucking in air as it cools down. So they do suck in quite a bit of air. So if you've got a hole in your boat, obviously it's not going to be sucking air, it's going to be sucking water. And when it's all over, don't forget to put your bung back. One of the big issues that you'll have with this boat is that you won't find any epoxy really that'll adhere to the boat to fill your hole or your crack. One epoxy that I've used is G-Flex. That was something that I found on eBay, and actually it does work. I've filled a couple of holes and one crack that I had where the rear beam is going through the boat. Now, one thing that you often have with the mixing up the epoxy is that you try and get it in the hole, or you try and get it in the crack, and it runs out. One of the methods I used to use with my fiberglass boat was that I would mix up my epoxy and mix in some baby powder so that I got it to a consistency that was like paste, so you could just paste it into the hole. With these boats, because they're quite thick, you never really know how big your crack is. Although, if you've got water getting into your hull, you know that you've got a crack somewhere. And if you find that you've got a crack that is really hard to get to, or any sort of crack in the hull, you're going to have to fix it right through from one side to the other to give you a bit of strength. And one way to get it to go into the hole is to actually remove some of the air from your hull by using your hose method. Your hose method through the through the bung at the back, put some epoxy in the crack or the hole, suck a bit of air out, and watch as the epoxy gets sucked in to the hole. Once you've got a reasonable amount sucked in there, release the pressure, and the epoxy with its little bit of baby powder will stay in that crack and seal it up, and it should be good.
Now there's that jib, bro. It's got stuck again. How often does that happen if you've got a jib?
Now if you've got a jib, you probably find that your lines often get caught around the front of your mast, particularly on your mast pin. Now to overcome that problem, I've made this little cover which goes over the front of your mast. It's just a 75mm plastic pipe cut down the middle with some plastic mouldings up here to protect your fingers. I've just covered it in make-believe carbon fibre so it matches matches your mast. On the bottom of here you put three pieces of rubber cut so they can like that, so that can go on the bottom of your mast and spread out over your bottom beam to keep your ropes from fouling your pin and the bottom of your mast.
Now just put the covering on the bottom of your mast, making sure to pull it right down.
Now obviously you've got your pin that goes through there. My jib rope often would get caught on the pin. On the bottom here I've got my downhaul bits and pieces. I've also got some cleats and other bits and pieces, and quite often the jib rope will get caught on the bits and pieces on the lower part of your mast. So that piece I just showed you will stop your jib from getting caught. Now a little bit about the mainsheet downhaul. The mainsheet downhaul on the boat is, I think, a 2-to-1 system. It comes with that, and I've replaced mine with a 4-to-1. It just makes fine tuning easier. That is a lot of downhaul for strong winds and less for lighter winds. Now this is a closer look at the nice little 4-to-1 downhaul that I've got. This makes getting the right tension in the sail quite easy. Easy to pull down, easy to release. So it's just a nice little thing. Not absolutely necessary, but nice to have.
Well, Hobie market this as a four-person boat, but I think it's more like a four-small-person boat because you've got seats like this, which aren't all that comfortable. If you're going to be doing a lot of sailing, you want to have a comfortable seat. Now, I've had this boat for 12 years, and I've finally settled on the best mat, the most comfortable. The rubber, it makes it nice and soft, and the top, which is just a doormat, a plastic type stuff, doormat, which makes it non-slip, so that's extremely comfortable. Now, because of where I mount my boat on the trailer, it means that the strap for the back of the trailer would come over the seat there. So what I've done is put a cover over there, so when it's tied down, it doesn't dig into the seat.
So that's the rubber, and the mat goes on top. It's also nice to have a soft seat to put your arm on when you're just laying back, having a lazy day sailing. Now, if you've ever capsized your boat, you probably found that if you're of a small build, that the riding rope is about in the right place. But if you're larger and weigh a bit more, you probably found that the riding rope is a bit too far forward. I always find that having my feet either side of that front beam and trying to get the boat up, I feel most unbalanced as the front of the boat tries to sink. Well, I'm going to show you a different way to mount your rope, and that's under your boat. Now, as I'm going to show you under the boat, I'll show you an easy way to turn your boat over using the power of the wind. If for any reason you have to turn your boat over, that way the halyard has got stuck at the top of the mast or your sail is jammed, you can use the power of the wind to turn your boat over. Firstly, turn your boat into the wind and pull down hard on your blocks, and then gradually turn your boat away from the wind until the hull just starts to lift up. Then you can go to your side stay, grab that and just gently roll your boat over. As it moves up, just reach under and grab the riding rope and gently lower it onto its side. Now, while my boat's on its side, note where the riding rope is. It's actually under the boat. It's held under the boat and it's attached to the rear beam via a bungee rope with a quick release clip. This makes it readily available in the event of a capsize. Now, I weigh 95 kilograms, and if I stand with my legs either side of the front beam, I feel that too much of my weight is forward. In the video clip, the first part is for smaller sailors who may need to use a longer length of rope for leverage. Obviously, if your boat is capsized in the water, you're going to be leaning out a lot further than I am here, but this is just to give you an idea of where to stand when riding your boat. The second part is for sailors like myself who need to stand further back on the boat away from the front beam and need less length of the riding rope. Now, on the back of your boat, you'll have a fitting like this, and it's through this that you put the first clip, and I'll show you the setup. Now, here's the clip we've just seen at the back of your boat. It's on this clip that you're going to attach your riding rope. Now, I'll show you how this is made up. This is just the end of your riding rope is here, and we've got three lengths of bungee cord going up to another clip. In between this clip and the end of your riding rope, you've got a piece of rope which allows your bungee cord to stretch to a certain length and not any further. Now, the main reason for the bungee cord is to keep your riding rope tight under your boat. This other cord lets you pull on your riding rope and allows you to get a bit of leverage to get your boat upright. Now, obviously, you're going to have to adjust the length of this bungee and this rope to accommodate your weight. If you don't weigh much, you're obviously going to have to unclip the whole thing and use the whole riding rope. But if you're like me and you weigh a bit more, you're not going to lead all the riding rope. You'll be able to move about a metre back from the front bar and pull, and be able to get your boat up much easier. So that's just the setup of what's at the back of the riding rope and attached to the back of your boat. I'll show you now how it looks when it's attached at the back of your boat. Now, you may wonder why I've got a couple of clips here and not just one clip coming down from the back. If you were to try and undo this clip, it's actually quite hard. This is much easier just to undo this to release your riding rope. So the setup, when it's sitting at the back of your boat, should look like this. Now, this rope here will drag in the sea if you leave it like this, and it sends up a bit of spray behind your boat, which you may not like. So you can just wrap it around your bungee and then just tuck it in to keep it out of the way. So all I've done there is separate the bungee cords
and tuck that rope in between them.
Now this is the size of the clip that you want to use, something big so it's nice and easy to undo.
For those of you who might be thinking about a winch, this was a winch I got on eBay. It was fairly cheap, but it does the trick. You'll also notice that I've left my manual winch on there, just in case have a failure of the electric winch.
Now, if you get in the track of having a winch, I'd advise you to install a chain like I've got here, which just chains down to the bottom of my trailer. There is a turnbuckle here which I can adjust the tension of the chain, because after a while it will start to stretch, but this will stop your winch pole from bending. Now these winches are very strong, so trust me, without a bit of chain there, your winch pole will bend. Guaranteed. Now your winch will come with this bracket here, but you will need to buy a 90 degree galvanized bracket to attach it to your trailer store. Now if you're going to attach an electric winch, or if you've already got a winch on your boat, then you probably have already got some mechanism to pull your boat up onto your trailer. But what I do is put a piece of chain over the front bar. Have that chain wrapped in plastic tubing so it doesn't hurt the bar, and then bring it around and combine it all with a shackle on the front. Now, with the winch, I've left my boat at the water's edge with the anchor out, and I'm going to use the method to get it onto my trailer as shown in my video, Easy Load Trailer. But this time I'm going to be using an electric winch. If you do get a winch, get one that comes with a remote which you can hang around your neck. That way you can easily guide the boat onto the trailer as it comes up out off the sand. Now when the boat has just lifted its stern off the beach, it's at this stage you can loosen your bungs to let any water out. In my case it looks like I've still got a few leaks. Then press your button and you can get your boat further up onto your trailer with your winch. The electric winch is just a nice feature, and if you're getting old like me or you don't have a lot of strength, it's just great to have. Now the rudder extension or hiking stick is obvious when you're sailing in high wind with your body over the side, as it gives you something to hang on to rather than hanging on to just your rudder rail on the boat. However, I use mine in light winds to allow me to have a more relaxed position on the boat. It allows me to sit a bit further forward, and it's particularly useful for those who might have shortened their rudder arms, as I had instructed in one of my videos on how to go faster and how to sit further back on your boat. Now as you can see, even small subtle movements of the tiller extension can easily steer your boat.
Now some of these manoeuvres may look a bit funny, but I'm just trying to show you how easy it is with your extension to move it around the back of your boat and to move it to wherever you want it to sail a bit more comfortably.
I'm going to do the tiller extension now because it's featured in the next series of videos. Well, this is the tiller extension I've used. It's a Ronstan battle stick, model number RF3114. It's telescopic, mounts on your back steering bar, and it goes from 740mm to 1120mm. So that's the battle stick by Ronstan. If you go down the path of installing a hiking stick, make sure that you install it with stainless steel nuts and bolts. and not the pot rivets that might have come with it. I've found on one occasion that the pot rivets came loose, which resulted in me nearly falling off my boat as it's hanging onto the hiking stick. Now, the other thing to make sure of when you install this is to have your rudders down. I made the mistake of installing mine first with the rudders up, which meant that when the rudders went down, the hiking stick was mounted in the wrong place. Now, you may notice that my hiking stick is mounted on this extra bar here. I installed this bar when I cut my rudder arms so that I could sit further back on the boat. This topic was covered in my video, Modifications to Go Faster. So my hiking stick is mounted in the same place as yours would be, but it's mounted on this extra bar.
Now tacking, here is a tack at normal speed. Note that my foot is on the main sheet rope. I'll explain what I'm doing in slow motion in the next clip. Now you really got to make sure that your main sheet rope isn't cleated in your blocks. Now put your foot on the main sheet rope. This frees up your hand and aids in your balance, and it also keeps the power in your sail to enable you to enter the tack with some speed. As you put your foot on the rope, push the rudder away from you to commence your tack. It helps if you have a tiller extension. I'll talk about this later. Now, as you duck under the sail, your foot is off the rope and the mane is free to go to the other side of the boat. If you've got a jib, as you duck under the sail, you can reach over and unclip your jib rope from its cleat. In most instances, this will allow your jib to go around your mast on its own. Now you may notice that I have a rather long jib rope, but this is because I have three different sizes of jib. Now for a jibe. Now the thing to watch for here is when the sail flicks over to the other side of your boat. It's important never to be cleated in. This is the point where most capsizes happen on any boat, when you get caught by a gust of wind unexpectedly.
Now let's have a look at a jibe in slow motion.
Now again, watch for the sail as it cracks from one side of the boat to the other. In high wind, this can really move quite fast and make a loud noise. I personally think that doing a jibe and letting your sail crack from one side to the other is not doing your sail or your eyelet any good and puts it under a lot of strain.
Just to clarify that statement about jibing, for any of you who sail in a club and your sail ran a course, obviously you're going to have to do some jibing. I'm talking about recreational boating, where I do try and avoid doing a jibe as much as possible. But of course, if you're racing, you're going to have to learn how to do that. Those magpies. Those magpies just love me making videos. They wait till I come outside and then they start singing. There they go.
Now just as a little aside, my boat has a 6-to-1 pulley system for the blocks, and this clip shows just how easy it is to sheet in after a jibe or a tack. It also shows the tack from the other angle and how I use the tiller extension to push on the rudders for my tack. Now stuck in irons. It is such a thing, although it sounds funny. Have you ever started to tack and got halfway through your tack and you've stalled? Now this is called being stuck in irons. I found a simple way to get through the tack is to grab your main sheet ropes and pull them hard towards you while pushing on your rudder. Now the idea here is to rotate the boat under you. If you look at the background, you'll see how the boat is rotating.
As soon as you see the slightest hint that the wind is now hitting the other side of the sail, duck under and complete your tack. If you've got a jib, carefully watch this, and as soon as it's moved even slightly to the other side of your mast, sheet it in and the boat will complete its turn. It should be noted here that despite what some people might say about a jib will make it easier, I repeat, will make it easier to tack your boat. Now here's a stalled tack from the opposite side.
Sometimes in high winds, you've really got to pull on those blocks hard to get your boat to turn around. Now this is just another example of a 6-to-1 block usage, but watch what I do with the rope in my hand. I'm curling that rope 2 or 3 times around my hand.
Now the reason for doing this is that when you're sailing along, if you find you get a bit too much power in your sail, you can open your fingers and let some rope out. If you still need some rope out, you've got another line you can let out there. So that's just a way you can release some of the power from your sail by letting go of the rope. Now look, you may have noticed at the back of my boat I have rubber fillings. If you take these off, it's just a big hole here. And when you're putting your foot on the main sheet rope, this is about where it's going to go. So it might be advisable to actually do what I've done, and you just have a piece of rubber that goes over that section there. And that can just be with stainless steel screws, that can just be screwed into your trampoline rope. Without that rubber, you might find that your foot is going down this hole and getting caught. Now, before we leave the topic of tacking and jibing, I want to tell you about an incident that I had last year where I actually got my foot caught in the hiking strap and I was trapped on the wrong side of the boat. And I'll show you how this happened and perhaps what you can do to help yourself if this situation occurs with you. So let's say this is my foot. I've got my foot in here while I'm hiking along, and then I go to do a tack to go to the other side of the boat. You take your foot out and over you go. In my case, I accidentally put my foot back under here and I twisted. So my foot was caught in the strap. So my foot was this side and I was the other side of the boat. Now, what this means is that the wind had come now to the other side of the boat and I was in danger of capsizing with my foot caught in the strap. So as a result of that, I've now got a safety knife attached to my belt on my life jacket. So on my life jacket, now with an easy reach, I have a knife which is attached to my belt. And it's just a matter of putting your thumb in here and pulling, and it comes out and you've got a knife that you can cut a strap on your boat, or if you get caught in any ropes, it'll cut your ropes. So that is a handy gadget to have on you just in case you get your foot caught in the strap or you get caught in the ropes if you have a capsize. So now you could just use your knife to cut through your strap like that, or to cut through any ropes. Well, it certainly was a marathon, wasn't it? But I hope that's given you some ideas on some different things you can do with your Hobie to make it safer to sail and more enjoyable to sail. These Hobie boats are really tough. I sail mine in the Southern Ocean off the coast of South Australia in big swells and high seas. And after 12 years, the old Hobie's still going strong. So as I always say, have fun on your Hobie and catch you later from Australia. Cheers.